All right, here we are. Wednesday night, January 1st, 2014. Subject that has been coming up, unfortunately, time and time again, is whether a child can bury their father. It seems that there are two prevalent customs, and one custom seems to be taking more of a stronghold, and that is that the children cannot bury their father. And the rabbis do their utmost to prevent the children from going to the cemetery. So we want to find out if this has any basis whatsoever, if it's correct, if it's incorrect, what it's based upon, what do we learn from history, what are the different customs involved. And we're going to look at a teshoubah from a book called Shelomo. This teshoubah was written by Rabbi Shelomo Dayan, who is, we'll call him a resident of Jerusalem. Okay, he's alive. Yes, he's alive. So, here's our teshuvah. Al minhag Yerushalayim tibanev tikonen she'en habbanim melavim aron abihim. The title tells you a lot. There is a custom today in Jerusalem that the children do not accompany the casket of their father. So obviously this is something that is in practice, and when I made phone calls to find out, the Chabra Kadisha in Jerusalem is very, very strict about this. They will not let the children accompany the body to the grave under any circumstance.
Kohen, not Kohen.
Makes no difference. You are a child of this father, and you're burying your father. You want to bury your father in Jerusalem? You're not going to be there. Done. You want to bury him in Israel? Go to another city. It's not happening in Jerusalem. Now, I'm sure some of you are unhappy about this. Mark?
I think it's idiotic.
You think it's idiotic?
Absolutely idiotic.
But if it's a custom of that city and you're going there to bury your father.
I'd like to hear his basis.
It's a custom of the city, but it may not be your custom. They're going to impose their customs on
you
now?
Yes, this is Jerusalem.
Nonsense.
So if your father dies here, you want to be buried in Yerushalayim?
You're following their custom.
If you had enough money, you probably could do whatever you want.
Nope. They won't let you. It's not happening.
Is this where people who...
Who's stopping you there?
What's the question?
Does anybody come from Brooklyn and be buried in this spot?
This spot? I mean, in any cemetery in Jerusalem? Yeah.
Exactly.
Yes.
And the children don't go?
That's correct.
So when children fly with the bodies, they just fly with the body on the plane?
Basically, they get there and then the whole procession takes over for them. Right. Yeah.
Wow. I'm going to find out from my cousin who did that a few years ago.
You're more than welcome to find out.
I went to visit the...
It's very true.
Joey, Shalom.
Yeah.
His kids went.
But they didn't go to the burial. They did not go to the burial. At most they got was to the gates of the cemetery.
They stopped them? They physically stopped
them? Oh, yeah. Who stopped them?
The Hebra and the rabbis. All the rabbis.
I would go and
they would give you your body to go elsewhere.
Wow.
This is a fact. I made phone calls to find out. This is definitely the case. But please, make your phone calls. Have fun.
2 years ago. Okay.
All right, let's read the teshuvah now. Hen shurutaim ille kemochehen yisabtim afasitim na'alot ala kitab kama pitputim yidin de oraitab anyan min hagi ila kodesh ilu shalayin tibbanim tikonin bidbar hadikhat habbanim ahar aron abihim ahar shirayiti bekama levayot et sa'ah mishpahot ha'almano vayitumim mehura azo vaf alpi shigamni hara al hadabar azeh בראותי את נעקתם וזעקתם, שמתי לפי מחסום פני כבוד התורה של המורים כן, כי אמרתי, די במה שגלמו על ידי הוראה זו שפתיים מקרב משפחות והקרובים, שהיו מטיחים דברים קשים על אותם הרבנים וכולי, ועל כגון דה כבר אמרו החכמים זר, החיים היזהרו בדבריכם. We'll stop right now. He's saying, in a nutshell, I wrote these few lines, like 10 pages, because after I witnessed the sorrow of a number of families that had a very difficult time with wanting to go and bury their father, and they were not allowed, and they were crying and screaming, and I kept my mouth shut because I said, it's enough that they're getting shambled by the family, I don't need to open my mouth, you know, also. But it's reached a point where I can't sit back any longer, and I have to discuss, you know, this issue, and we have to get to the point that they want to get to. Okay? V'chein, k'shem shemizvah lomar davar nishma'a, k'ach mizvah shelo lomar davar she'enu nishma'a. Because you have to, when sometimes you have to open your mouth and say something, sometimes you don't have to say something. Uma gam, shelifi aniyut da'ati, en li'isur ze shenahagu bo birushalayim tibbanei v'tikonein binyan ab. Hen mishad ad-din, hen mishad ad-sekhla yashar ha-sedik v'higayon ha-pashut. Because in bottom line, I'm writing about this, because this isur that they have created a custom of in Yerushalayim has no foundation whatsoever. Sure. Not from the deen and not from logic. Ach, any omer halida, kiblu da'ati, ki ma min niya haluq lehorot hura oda rabbin va'adayin hu higyati lehidim iddazo shil ba'adit shuba umore hura'a. But I'm not telling you, listen to me, because who am I to say anything? Obviously, I'm not on the level of these great hachamim. Umikum makum. לחברים מקשיבים ושואלים דעתי אני אומר שכל אחד יאחוז במנהג אבותיו כי כל העניין הזה הוא מנהג שאינו מחובר ולא ברור ותולו מדי. Because obviously I'm not telling anybody to listen to me, but to my friends who, you know, listen to me and ask my opinion, I tell them, hold on to your original מנהגים and don't listen to these customs that make no sense. אך על המורים בחזקה ומפחידים את הבנים בדברים הדברים. כביכול, מהנזק שיגיע להם אל אביהם מהליווי הזה, עוונם יישאו. You like that, Mark? Okay? Saying that this is what I have to say to those teachers, those rabbis, those leaders that give ruling with force and they instill fear in the children with what they say and they try to give them this image that they are causing damage to their father by accompanying them, Avon is on their head. Because they are transgressing the mitzvah lo ta'aseh, that you are not allowed to cause anguish to the widow and to the orphan. Ve'anu hazal. וכן עוברים לו על לא תונו איש את עמיתו ופרשו חזה שלא יסערנו דברים קשים מלשון והאכלתי את מונעך בשרם מעיין כל זה בספר חרדים ולבד כל זה עוברים ובד תוסיף היגונם של האבלים הדוויים היושבים על משבר באבלם דאבתם. We'll go on and on again. He's going on that they are causing more sorrow, more unnecessary sorrow, more troubles, more anguish for these abedim, and they're not allowed to do it. Haram. Ve'en sefek, he called ille shigormim v'dibrehem sa'a l'hayim v'lamimitim v'ra'a zo, u'bifat k'ashe ne'emet, v'hamimut yitera, v'omdim al omdam ba'li aburun, k'illu shehura'a zo yarda min ashamayim, u'k'illu hal aliha isur k'ahada isurim ha'hamurim shem ha'torah, v'hu rahum y'chaper ba'adam. He goes, and these people, they are standing there, and they are being unyielding, and they're being tough, and they're being rough, and they're being forceful, and they're saying, this is the law. They're not telling you this is a custom, or it's a good thing to do, or it's a warning from the Zohar. They're giving it to them like, this just came down from Sinai right now, and this is it. They are making a terrible sin, and let's see, on not allowing these children to do what they feel they need to do. As we say, he goes, and let's see if they're going to get any kapara for the sin that they're causing.
Causing them of not to go.
Yes, that's what he's saying.
Right.
Doesn't mean he's right.
Right.
Doesn't mean he's wrong. But this is his stance. He's going, you know, to attack.
I like him.
Yeah, sorry, what's his name?
His name is Shelomo Dayan.
That's my buddy.
V'hineh. L'anyan dina. לא ידעתי סד איסור בהליכת הבנים אחר ארון אביהם. He goes, let's deal with the deen. He goes, I know no yisur whatsoever in the children going after their father's coffin. Shehari mikraot mifurashot hem b'Torah. Shehabanim kubrin abihim. We have pesukim, clear, black and white, that the children go.
It's just fathers or fathers and mothers? Just fathers.
Fathers.
Just
fathers.
Just fathers.
Just fathers. For mothers, nobody has a problem.
Of going, you're right.
Right. כמו שכתוב אצל אברהם אבינו עליו השלום ויגברו אותו ישחק וישמעאל בנו אל מערת המכפלה. Right? Who buried right. Abraham? Torah tells us. ישחק וישמעאל. Sons buried right. The father. That's number one. וכן מישחק אבינו עליו השלום שנאמר ויגבע ישחק ויאמות יאסף אל עמיו וכן ויגברו אותו עשיו ויעקב בניו. Who buried him? ישחק died. He was buried by his sons. Right? וכן ביעקב אבינו עליו השלום נאמר ויעל יוסף לקבור את אביו וכל בית יוסף ואחיו ובית אביו ועומר ויישאו אותו בעניו ארץ הקנה ויקברו אותו במערת שדה המכפלה אשר קנה אברהם. Who went to bury him? All the boys. All of them. All the שבטים. They all went. ועל הכתוב ויישאו אותו בעניו. Okay, on those three words. פירוש, פירש לשי. What did she explain? ולא בני בעניו. Not his grandchildren. שכך סיבם אל יישאו מתתי לא איש מסרי וכולי אלא אתם. He commanded them, Yaakov commanded them, don't let other people, you know, deal with my body, just you guys. וקבע להם מקום, גימן למזרח, וכן, לארבר רחוק, סדרן למסע מחנה, באו שמסע להם אביהם, יישא מתתו, and then she continued to explain, they told him exactly how he wants them to carry the body and take it. So, this is the children that carried it. Children of Abraham took him. Children of Yitzhak took him. Children of Yaakov took him. So we know from our abot, right? We have the three abot of our nation. And they were all buried by their sons. Period. וכתב הרב הקדוש מקובל האלוהי בעל מעבר יבוק זלה במאמר אמן נועם בזה לשונו. והבן מעלה האב על שכמו למעלה עטרה לתעטר בעולם העליון מעשיו הטובים. וזהו סבאת יעקב לבניו בנשיאת מיתתו. ומנהג התלמידים הנושאים מיתת רבם. כי במה שאמר הכתוב באברהם ישחק ליעקב כי קברו אותם ביניהם. נראה כי ניחא גדולה יהיה לאב עי שבניו יעסקו בקבורתו. ויאמכן בדי יהיה זכות והנאה לבן בחייו ומותו. ולא לחינם מן הגן של ישראל להקפיד על זה כפידה גדולה. ומחול יעקב בשבעת בניו ופלטי כבורתו ומלווים אותו בעבר הכבד שעשו בעבורו. ושם יש למשכיל לדרוש ולהבין כמה פלטים בביקור חולים והלוויית המת כבורתו בקיתו ואבידתם עליו ועשיגת בן בסמכי כבורת אביו משם יהיה לבן זכות אבות ואוב נוסף לו ממנו וכולי עד כן לשונו. So he's bringing in a major Kabbalist and he's quoting from him and he's saying that we need to realize that what happens, the son lifts up the body of the father, placing it on the shoulders to take it to be buried. It's like he's raising his father up and making him as a crown on his head. And this is exactly what the last will and testament of Yaakov was to his sons when he told them to lift and carry his body. And this is the same custom of the Talmidim when they carry the body of their rabbis. When we look carefully at what's written in the Mikra, in the Humash, about Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, how they were all lifted and carried and buried by their children, we understand that it must be a great comfort to the father, knowing that his sons were involved in his burial. And obviously, it's a tremendous zechut and a, he calls it a hana'a, a pleasure, but obviously he doesn't mean pleasure in a happiness pleasure, but it's more like a
fulfillment,
satisfactory feeling or something or the other for the child in his life to know that he was able to do this last thing for his father and not to just leave his father, you know, to the side. And this is not, this is obviously wasn't done for naught, okay? That we know through the generations that Am B'nai Yisrael was always very, very careful and scrupulous in doing this. And obviously if we look at the Humash, we see from the entire story of Yaakov Abinu, from when he got sick till the time he was buried, the Torah is obviously giving us all a lesson of how to fulfill mitzvah of Bichur Holim, how the children and the grandchildren need to come to the father, to the grandfather before he passes away, for to learn as a role model, to get instructions on how to continue life, to what to do in, you know, when it's time to bury him, and how they all went, and the great mourning that was done. All these are lessons for us. So obviously, this what we see with Yaakov Abinu and with the other Abod, but especially Yaakov, this is the way we're supposed to be conducting ourselves. And this is not written by a Pashtan, by a regular rabbi. This is written by a great Mikubal. So he's telling you, so according to Piyasod, if people want to tell you, Piyasod and the Zohar and this and that, well, here's a big gimmick about rabbi writing about it, and he's writing differently than what we would normally think. Ya'al Pizze Amarti, Be'ezer, Sedeb, Eich Afshar, Sedechir Lamdu Hazar Shish Ma'il Asat Shuba, Be'dav Kame Kiburat, Abihir, Mishnigwat Abraham. כדי לא להטיל איבה, לכן לא ברכו, עד שבא הקדוש ברוך הוא בירך לישחק. אבל עתה, בקיבולת אברהם, זכה ישמעאל שיהיה לו זכות אבות, ואור הנושא בקרבו, ולכן אמר ראשי על פי חזל, מכאן שעשה ישמעאל תשובה, כלומר שבקיבולת אביו אברהם, זכה לתשובה שלמה, ועזה היא סיבה טובה שנאמרה באברהם, בדוק. I don't see what the point of this was, but basically we see what when Ishmael came and was involved in burial of Abraham, it's what really brought Ishmael back to doing teshuvah shelema. So it's a lesson for us to keep in mind that helps us maybe, you know, if we're actually involved in the burial of our fathers when it's time, so it may help you to do teshuvah. Okay. Yes, sign point. It has nothing to do with what we're studying, though. That's what bothers me over here. You could study a lot off of that, but it just doesn't really work for what we want. וזהו כבודו של מת ותפעלת בנים בחייהם ומותם ומעשה אבות סימן לבנים וכמעשה אבותינו ראוי לנו לעשות ככל מעשה האבות הכתובים בספר התורה הקדושה הם כדי ללמד לבנים והורות נתן לנו את תורתו לשעה ולדורות למען נזכיר בדרך אשר בה נלך בעת המעשה שנעשה. ואם כן, מאחר שכך נהגו אבותינו הקדושים שהבנים קברו את אביהם, אף אנחנו בדרכם נלך ולא נזוז מנהגה הטוב הישר. ומנהג זה שהבנים מלווים את אבותם היה לעולמים מזמן אבותינו עליהם השלום, ונמשך לדורות הבאים עד עשר הימים הזה, במזרח ומערב בכל כזבי טריבל, ואין פוסי פה ומספסף. Bottom line, what's the most important thing that we need to learn from the writing of Ma'abari Abok? That the minhag of Yisrael was a minhag that they were very, very scrupulous and very careful with, you know, not to forego whatsoever. And why was this done? Obviously because it brought this peace of mind to both parties involved, to the father and to the son. But more than that, it is the point of giving that kabod to the niftar. And the whole point over here is upkeeping this custom and this chain from father to son, from son to the, you know, to his son, to his son, to his son, along the generations. And bottom line is, we need to respect our fathers, and we always talk about minhagim and keeping our minhagim. So this obviously is an ancient minhag that goes back to our forefathers, you know, and Torah put it in writing for us. The only reason it could have put it in writing for us in the Torah, because obviously there's a lesson to be learned, and it's for us to learn to do the same, and for us to upkeep that minhag. And this is something that has always been done, he's telling you in the end, and Mishach Dorot HaBa'im has continued for generations to come until this very day, in the East and in the West. In other words, amongst Sephardim and Ashkenazim throughout the world, throughout all four corners of the earth, and nobody ever opened their mouth about it. וכן על אבי ועל אמו חולס כתפו ומוסי זרועו מן החלוק שתגלה כתפו וזרועו והולך כך לפני המטה ואחר שקבל אבי ואמו אין הוא חייב לחלוס. Very, very clear הלכה. He has brought us from the Rambam. Okay? Something that we don't do in our day, modern day and age, hasn't been done for at least the last few hundred years. Okay, and he's telling you, the reason obviously he's bringing you because the Rambam mentions father and mother, and that's what he wanted to show you. He's not just saying, you know, when you go to a funeral or when you're burying somebody, he's using specifically father and mother to show you, obviously, that, you know, they're equal in this case. Chodes ketefo, umusiz it all. Basically, what you're doing is, it's not just tearing, you're actually opening up your shirt or your gown or your cloak, you're revealing, what do you call it, your shoulder, your arm is coming out, and that's basically you're walking around, if you want, you know, partially naked in a sense. That's the way it comes out. Ashid gelek etefo, it has to be completely uncovered. Everybody has to see it. Uzdo'o, veholech kach lefnei hamitah, this is the way you walk in front of, what do you call it, in front of the coffin. Ve'ahashi kebir abi ve'imo eno hayav lehaz, but once they're already buried, then you don't need to do this anymore. But once, before the burial happens, this is what you need to do. ומקור הדין מהברייתא במועד קטן שאמרו על כל המתים כולם עושה חולס עשה אינו חולס על אבי ואמו חולס. Well, if you want to do it, you can do it. You don't want to do it, you don't do it. But if it's your parent, your father, or your mother, you must do it.
He's saying to rip
before the burial.
Before the burial.
Yes, it's before.
The
this is not talking about ripping. This is not ripping.
It's prevailing.
This
it's
is revealing. Not kiri'ah. Yeah. Absolutely not. This is called halisat katef. Okay? We're revealing the shoulder. Bekatab kesef mishneh. The halisat katef eina illa lisayt kach lefneh hamita. This is only done to go out, what do you call it? When accompanying the body, accompanying the coffin. משום דלשנה דברייתא הכי מוכרח מדקטני בסוף פרק חמה דבקמה וכבור עשו לו במותו זה חזקיהו מלך יהודה שיעשו לפניו למדבב אלף חלוסי כתף. This is the way they went out when they did the burial of Hezekiah, the king of Yehuda, that 36,000 people went out this way, חלוסי כתף, with his revealed shoulders. Hare, shebidibrehem beferush itemar, sheolchim habanim lelavot et aron hahorim lebet olamim. We see very clearly that the sons go to accompany the casket of their parents to the, what do you call it, the cemetery. כמו שכתוב הרמב״ם והולך כך לפני המיטה, וכן כתב בטור והשולחן ערוך, וכן נוהגים עד עצם היום הזה אחינו יהודי תימן, השם עליהם יחיו, ללכת לפני מיטת אבותם חלוסי כתף, כמו שהורה הרמב״ם ז"ל, ישר חילם, כי זהו מעיקר הדין, וכן פסקו הריב והראש ז"ל. So this is the halakha from the Rambam, from the Rish, from the Rosh, and the only people that still do it today are the Yemenites. Nobody else does it anymore. So I don't know.
Not even like a.
I thought that this existed until a few hundred years ago. Oh,
his shoulder thing.
Yes. Yeah, the shoulder thing.
Who does it? I'm sorry.
Only the Yemenites.
They still do it today.
They still do it today.
We went to a Yemenite.
We have to get you to one.
Listen.
Yeah, listen.
The Yemenite website.
I'll talk to Rabbi Edmoni for you.
Joey, was he saying that they rip the clothes?
No, they reveal.
Reveal.
Okay. Okay.
Evil.
هين إميد أنا لا نهجنا بزمن الزيل عصود حديثات كتيف. Well, yeah, it's true. We don't have the minhag nowadays to do this حديثات كتيف. عفل بيش كاخ نفسكاها اللخاء بريشونيم شحالوف. Even though this is what's laid down the law as law in the ريشونيم and even شحالوخ. وأنو نهجين كموش كتاب مرام شام بهجها. But we follow مرام. We follow the Ramah. We follow the rulings, the glosses for the Ashkenazim. Which says what? Akhshav is man hazeh. Lo nahagnu lahalos katef kelal. Vechen nohagin ha'idana.
That was not possible.
What's that?
That was not possible.
We took? We told Rambam?
And Shachan Aruch, the food.
No.
That was only
Rosh.
The man who did that?
No. What?
That was a man and lady? Or
so
just
how
a man?
That, how do you explain that?
What do you mean man and lady?
That revealed their shoulder.
No.
Only men.
Everybody.
I'm not understanding the question.
No, I'm saying the women
do that also.
Women did not go to funerals.
Yeah, women were home.
It was men. It was only
so
men.
So how do we explain this? We're following the Ramah, the Sephardim. Everyone says to do this halakha.
Uh-huh.
Every across the board.
Yep.
Why?
It's not uncommon. It happens a lot.
Let's hear it now. Let's see now.
Like,
except for your brother-in-law.
That we go against Maran, Alaman, the Tool, and the Nation, and both.
Happens. It's not like it's uncommon.
There's no mentioning Aaron on this table, by the way. Mm-hmm.
The Katab. Okay, so bottom up. We toss out the Rishonim, we toss out Shuharu, we follow Moram. We just don't do it, he tells you. The Katab Harav al-Lebush. דמה שלא נהגים במדינות אלו לחסות כלל אפשר משום דחשיב לן זילותה רבה אפילו לשפל ועניש בישראל ועבדה כמו אין כבודוש במהן. But the Bush is saying, well, maybe nowadays it wouldn't be considered a kabod because even the poorest of poor, you know, doesn't walk around that way. You know, so it's not something that would be done. עוד ראיתי להגאון מהרי פלאג'י בספר יפה ללב בקונטרוס האחרון על אורח חיים שהביא דברי מורם בהגאה ובאיר היטב ועוד הביא מדברי מהריקש שכתב שמקום שעטיפת הראש מביא לידי שחוק פטורים מהעטיפה. So another thing they did in the Abelim did besides the חליסת כתב, they also did עטיפת הראש. They would wrap their entire head, okay, with a cloth, obviously. And basically, Mahari Kash writes, it'd be Yaakov Kasro, if you're in a place where doing this Atifa Rosh would end up causing, instead of causing, you know, understanding and compassion and, you know, and consolation, but it would end up causing a joke. And people would make fun of it and cause laughter, then Piturim Atifa, you're exempt from it. So this could basically fall into the same thing. People are going to walk around like that. People are going to start laughing. What's going on over here? Look at all these Jews walking down the street like this, you know, bearing a shoulder. So it could be one of those type of things. Mishaykhin katab maran abiyu hagarah bihayim palachi. Mishayfir wahayim. Usof debaraf katab ilashinu. Koshakim bahalisat katab shihuli ayin kol sikh ro'abil agwa alav alav ishaqum. Like I just said, people, so the Bihayim Palach is saying, people are going to be walking down the street, like walking like that, with a bared shoulder, everybody's going to laugh at them. Look at these fools. And somebody wants to be mahmir in a place where this is not the custom. And him, this is a sin that he's causing him. Because instead of crying over the deceased, people are going to be laughing. ואם הוא תלמיד חכם הוא מחלל תורה חלילה וחס. And if he's got this guy's תלמיד חכם, he's מחלל תורה. כי לעולם יהיה אדם נגד עיניו התפילה שהביא ריבה וכתבתיה על לוח לבי בספר יפה ללב חלק ראשון ביושלבה שבקש האדם שלא יתחלל שמו יתברך לידו ושלא יהיה שיחה בפיה בריאות. Every time a person does something, he needs to take into consideration how is this going to be perceived. I have to make sure that no matter what I do not cause any Hilul Hashem. I do not cause any Hilul Torah. I cannot cause any hilul am Yisrael. This is what he's trying to get at. If you're going to do something that's going to cause a mockery of the Torah, of our religion, of the Jewish nation, of Borei Olam, this becomes an avon. Reh kama yahmir baze. Bidbar shel lechora kalhu b'ketef Yisrael. V'kara zeh mahalil ha-Torah v'chalil Hashem. Lamrot she'er oseh lahmir. B'ayinav yireyev sechlo yachshov shehu mekayim ha-Torah v'et ha-Halakha pesukav shaharu. No, what am I doing wrong? I'm following the halakha. What do you mean? This is what the Hakamim said. This is what the Rishonim said. I'm not doing anything wrong. I'm following Rabbah. I'm following Shulchan Aruch. Umikam uda'a Rabbah l'orayta. Wake up, people. Realize what's going on. Ve'enkan ma'kom neharich v'day bazeh. Because I don't have to keep going on about it. You have to realize, if you're going to cause a mockery of our religion, you cannot do it. Ve'chen katab harab ba'al Shulchan Gavowa. Sheminhag Saloniki. שלא לעתו פרוש, כמו שכתב הרב המפה, במסוך דקיים עליה, הלכה בדבריה מקל, באבל. Like we have a general rule that when it comes to abilut, we are lenient with everything. General rule. If you have any question when it comes to an issue of abilut, be lenient. והרוסה, תשנו ממה שנהגו, and if you want to change something that's already established, again, keep in mind, if it's going to cause laughter, if it's going to cause a mockery, don't do it. This is a minhag hadash that should not be done. If it's going to be something that's going to, it's going to be beneficial, then obviously you can, you know, you could implement it. Otherwise, you cannot. So he learned simply why we don't do halisat katif, all right, the revealing of the shoulder nowadays, because kavod b'riyot, human decency, and if doing it is going to cause a mockery. ובפרט בעשות הגויים ההם ואויבינו ילעגו לנו וישחקו לעינינו ויבוזו לנו. If we're going to do it in front of the Goyim, we're living in the land of the Goyim, for sure they're going to make fun of us. מפני שלא יתחלל שם ישראל בין האומות בטו חליסת כתף. וכן בעניין חליסת מנעלים במקום גויים. כתבו הפוסקים שאינו מחויב לכם בלי מנעלים. Same thing, when you have issue of Kippur, or Tisha'a B'Av, or you're an Abel, and you're not allowed to wear leather shoes. But if you would wear non-leather shoes outside in the street, it would be something that they would make fun of you and the religion, then you would be allowed to wear leather, even at these times, to go to get from point A to point B. And obviously, once you get to where you have to go, you remove them. Fine. בספרו שולחן גבוה, back to שולחן גבוה, שמנהג סלוניקי וכל ארץ תוגרמה, כדעת הרמה, שלא לחלוס כתף. So שולחן גבוה is telling you that the minhag of Saloniki, Salonika, Greece, and all of Turkey, follows Muram, not to reveal the shoulder. וסיים וזה שונו. אבל פה ירושלים, תברא ותכונן, ראיתי בפטירת הרב, כמו מורנו הרב מאיר מזרחי, בעל פרי הארץ, שיעשו לפניו בניו ותלמידיו חלוסי כתף ולא ראיתי עוד. Because I happened to have been in Yerushalayim at the time when Rabbi Meir Mizrahi passed away, and his children and his students went out revealing their shoulder. But I never saw this again.
This is a
Moko.
No, not Moko.
What's the question?
Shulchan Gavoa or
Yitzchak Atre
Zahav?
Atre Shalom
saying this.
No, no. Yitzchak Moko saying this.
He's quoting that.
Moko is saying this. Shulchan Gavoa is saying it. Velechora mashma' medebre kodsho sheirad b'tirad ba'al peri ha'aris asu ma'aseh b'lushalayim v'halesu katef sheiris yem velo ra'iti. Oh, exactly like we said. He goes, it seems this is what a unique occurrence. He saw it one time and one time only, that there was a funeral where they went out halusei katef, and it was for this Rabbi Meir Mizrahi, But he never saw it for any other funeral again.
This is, when is this? 1900s?
No, this is 1700s. The mashma' שגם בירושלים לא נהגו חריסת כתף כי אם בפעם הזאת לכבוד רב רבנן בעל פרי הארץ שהיה גדול בדורו וכל תלמידיו היו גדולי הדור. Okay? Only for this great rabbi who was גדול הדור and all his children were גדולי הדור that they do this חריסת כתף. ואשר על כן נהגו בו כבוד רב בחריסת כתף. So there's an extra level of כבוד בדון חריסת כתף. ולכן סיין הרב שולחן גבוה למעשה רב שראו עיני קודשו ולא עוד. And that's why שולחן גבוה even mentioned it because it was something so unique, something so outstanding that you know nobody ever believed that such a thing would have happened because you don't see this at all. אלא שראינו לגדול בישראל ומופת דורו מהרי עייש שחי באותה תקופה של הרב בעל פרי הארץ והרב בעל שולחן גבוה שכתב בספרו שבט יהודה יורה דעה וזה לשונו עובר הקודש ירושלים תיבנה ותכונן עד היום נוהגים בחריסת כתף שמוסיעים זרועותיהם מן הבית מן הבית הסבר ואינן קורעים כלל ונותנים אפר על גבי הכתף ועל הראש על כן לשונו ולכאורה שתראה נינהו על המנהג בירושלים בחריסת כתף. So now we have Rabbi Yehuda HaAyash. Rabbi Yehuda HaAyash was one of the greatest rabbis of Algeria. And he lived at basically at the same time period of Rabbi Meir Mizrahi of Piri HaAlas and the Shulchan Gavoa, B'Yishak Mulko. And he writes in his book, Shibut Yehuda, that even though we don't do Harisat Katef, I know for a fact that in Yerushalayim they do it. Until this very day, Harisat Katef is done. That they take their arms out, they reveal, you know, and their arms are exposed up to their neck, the shoulder is exposed, and they put ash, what do you call it, on the shoulder and on the head. So he goes, so now we have a contradiction. Was Harisat Katev done in Yerushalayim all the time? Or was it only done on that one occasion?
When was that?
We're talking about this time period, 1700s. Look up the exact date if you need. Not a problem to find it. I know you weren't able to make it that day, though. There were no flights. והנה יוסיף דאחתי במה שכתב הגאון יפה ללב, חלק שלישי. ולשונו, הגאה ויש אומרים. יפה ללב, בישחק פלאטי, סן. הגאה ויש אומרים, דה עכשיו בזמן הזה. לא נהגו וכולי, עיין הרב שבית יהודה, שכתב בשנו, לעניין דינה אין לסמוך על מנהג, זה בסדיר לקיים לדברת החכמים, כמו שכתב בגמרא ובחוסרים, וגם שמענו עוד היום בארץ ישראל שנוהגים חריסת כתף, עד כאן. So, the affiliate of quotes רבי יהודה עייש, saying that מנהג of ירושלים, יסדו חריסת כתף. ומי ישמע אליו? בדבר שמורם, ראש גולת אריאל ערי אשכנז, הוא אמר דה עכשיו בזמן הזה, לא נהגו לחרוס כתף כלל, שהם דברי הכל בו, בסיים בו, וכן נוהגין העידנה. So you feel that they're saying, I understand, if Muram said we don't do it, that means nobody does it. That's it, that's the custom of the world nowadays. How could it be that this still exists in Yerushalayim? וכן הרב הלבוש כתב, ובמדינות אלו אינה נוהגים כלל בחריסת כתף. And we read the לבוש before, that he also said we don't do חריסת כתף. מטעמו ונימוקו עמו כי עויין שם באורך. We understand the reasoning behind it. וכמו כן, בכל ארץ תוגרמה, אין נוהגים כן, כדי הרב שולחן גבוה. We know שולחן גבוה, and we know ourselves is saying that they don't do חריסת כתף. Not in Salonika, Greece, and not in all Turkey. ומה שכתב עם פי השמועה, and what he wrote through the grapevine, what he heard, שבאי ישראל נוהגים בחריסת כתף, that in Israel they do it, more specifically in Yerushalayim, לפי דברי הרב שולחן גבוה שם, שכתב זה לשונו, אבל פה ירושלים ראיתי וכולי, נראה להפך שגם ישראל נוהגים לעשות בחריסת כתף כלל, אלא אחת הייתה ופרסמה כתוב שהפריזו על המידה. It would seem from the שולחן גבוה that this was a one-time occurrence, and that's why it was, you know, it got so much fanfare, and that's why it got written up, because it was a special occurrence. ומי זה אמר כי רוח חכמים גדולי הדור ההוא נוחה בזה And who said the Hachamim are even happy that this even happened? Because Zechut Mechra'at Kiv came and Shira'u Benav Talmidav Shita'aku Asman Bekach Lura Sulem Chol Be'edam Be'idan Litha B'Sha'at Chimum Shemei Yaseh Ezeb Bilbul. And maybe the Hachamim were very unhappy, but the sons and the students, they learned the Halakha and they felt they were doing the right thing in honor of their Hacham and their father. So they went ahead and did it. And because it was such a, you know, precarious time for them, and it could have set them back and caused a major mahluk and caused a ruckus, you know, so the Hachamim sat back and didn't say anything. You know, we'll just leave them alone. Let's not open our mouths. Let's just let them finish the funeral, and whatever happens, happens. Goes that's a possibility that the Hachamim weren't happy with it, and that's why it never happened again, because they told them something after the fact, you know, but not during the fact to cause a fight. And if what they did was something new and unheard of that nobody ever did, you know, and they came and all of a sudden they did it, then obviously what they did was wrong. ופוק חזה משכתב הרב בכי יוסף לכמן, משם הרב מהריקש, מעיין למערב מלכמן, בעניין עטיפה, שהוא גם כמדינה, שכתב שמקום שאין נוהגים עטיפה, אין להחמיר לשלום במה שלא ילהגו לבותינו, אין שם, על כמה שם הרב יפה לרב זה. So he went back to quote the same מהריקש and the other sources that we saw, that if it's going to cause any sort of חילול השם, obviously we have to annul it, even though this is something that was stated in the Rishonim and Shuharu. Umehar alod kose asima ainiye shere lefi kose aniyud da'ati. Then image of the hila ala mahashaba the farid ibn harabakalo shahan gabu azal ha. Kiosh katabla ayah shalat vapitirat ba'afiriha arz maharam zrahi. Now, what is the Katebe and Altami than Penicum with Okirahu? Mishmahmed, the Brickwood Show, the Barab, the Lora, it yaot. Ella Shine Hamti, Behaber, Zo Aharero, E. I do the Shine Manash, Rabakadosh, Mahri Ayash, Behada TV, Behadati B. Hikimi, Kemohamore, Behalefi, I do get the Doro. She called the Brittle at Tobah Hindu Shal Motim, and Merkase, it may become a Yoshin. Mehagi Onin, Maharit Al Gazi, Umari Hazabi, Utam, Beir, Padua, Bishat Club, Haidwo. שהיה מעין דוגמה של מעלה. הסילה הקדישה. רב דומה למלאך אדומי סבאות. ואיך שבא כגאון יפה ללב וחסילותיהם. ולחש כמחש הצדיק. ושדי נרגע ואמור אליו. למי ישמע לו וכו'. וחליל להתיר. והתיר בדברי קודשו בוקי סיליקה. ואם הוא הקדוש אמר להי מלתה ויעי בגודלו שכך הוא מנהג בירושלים בעיר ישראל שחוסים כתף מי יפה דבריו ואין משיבין את האלי לאחר ניתה ואחריה מחילה רבה מעצם קדושת עצמותיו של הגאון יפה ללב ומשיקת עפרות זהב לו שתחת כפות רגליו לא לקודשו כדברי נביאות הן דמן צדיק לעילה אתה ואמר שלא נהגו אבותיהם במחנה קודשם לקדושים שבארץ המה, שאומר עליהם, דלה יפה עשו לעשות חדשה בארץ בעיניי בתמידה של רב פרי הארץ זל. ומי זה אמר, כי רוח הקיימים גדולי הדור ההוא לא נוחה בזה, ואולי אפשר שכך יהיה המנהג בדורם, ולמה זה ירסו למחור בדבר שנהגו בו? So bottom line is telling you, I need to come and figure out what's the problem over here. I need to resolve the difference between the Shuhan Gaboa, talking about the one time, supposedly right. One funeral, time funeral of Ibn Mizrahi, that could have been the one thing, or what Rabbi Yehuda Ayesh is saying, that this is the Minhag of Yerushalayim to do all the time, or the Yefer Aleb is coming and saying that I think that maybe Ayesh is mistaken, and it really was a one time thing, and not only was it a one time thing, you know, the way we understand from the Shuhan Gaboa about the Periha Aris' funeral, but it could be even be that the Hachamim of the time were unhappy with this act that they did by Halisat Katif. So he's saying over here, yeah, So he's saying over here now, the author of this work, Rabbi Shelomo Dayan, he goes, I need to come and resolve these differences. That's number one. Number two, I don't see how, as great as the affiliate is, I don't see how anybody could come out against Rabbi Yehuda Ayash when all the greatest hachamim from around the world, even in Italy, wrote about him that he was like Malach Hashem. So there's no way he just, you know, said something out of hearsay without knowing for sure, and it couldn't have been a mistake. And then how could you come and talk about the children and the Talmidim that we know were amazing Talmidim, according to the Berkei Yosef, who was the Hidah, Hayim Yosef, Vida Azulai, who was the Berkei Yosef, writes about the Talmidim of the Pri Haaretz, the Talmidim of the Meir Mizrahi, that they were, each one was a Gaon Hador. How could you say that the Hachaim of that time were all unhappy with what they did? Because I have a problem with every aspect of the, you know, of these stories that I've just quoted. So I need to come and resolve everything.
Bring
him
to class.
First of all, if we look at what he wrote in his book Shebet Yehuda, about the minhag, we're talking about Bi Yehuda Ayash, writing that the custom of Yerushalayim and Israel to do Halisat Katef was written in his book Shevet Yehuda many years prior to the year Takat. Takat being 509. Okay, 509 being what? Come on, people.
509.
Let's go, Joe.
I'm waiting for all of you. 1749. Come on, wake up. 509. Okay.
What?
1749. 1749.
What's
509?
The Hebrew
year, 5509. Oh, I'm sorry. 509, we dropped the 5. Because the 5 is for the 5,000, and we got 509. Okay, 5509, right now on 5774. Right? Yes, 74. Yes, 5774. So subtract the years, we're talking about 1749. Shehari, Bisifro. It works, right? Take out your phones. You can do check the math, make sure it's right. Share b'sefro lechem Yehuda, who maskir et sefarim atay Yehuda v'shevet Yehuda shadai lehayu b'chtuvim. He goes, because we already know in one of his other works, he mentions these works are still in manuscript form. Shem, nechon, okay. Share. בספרו לחם יהודה הוא מזכיר את הספרים מתי יהודה ושבט יהודה שעליהם היו בכתובים ובשם בחידושי הלכות או חידושין כלאם ובדמתו לספר בית יהודה משנת תקד. Okay, so we're going back 5 years, we're going back to 1744. הזכיר שחיבי ספר לחם יהודה, אם כן, סבח שוב כמה וכמה שנים לפני שנת תקד שכתב את ספר שבט יהודה. So obviously he wrote שבט יהודה even years before 1744. We don't even know how many years before. ואם נכונים דברים, הרי שעדותו נאמנה לשנים הרבה לפני שנת תקד. So obviously this happened many years before 1749. לא כן הרב שולחן הגבוה, היא בגללו מה שראה אינה בשנת תקד. And שולחן הגבוה is talking about the funeral that happened in 1749. This was written years before. Okay, שהיא השנה שבה הם בישיבה של מעלה הרב בעל פרי העוז. ואפשר דעת שנת תקד נהגו בלשם חניסת כתב, על זה כתב מהריעה, שכתב הוא המנהג בלשם תקמלי בקנין. So, obviously, in earlier years, it would seem, based upon what the Yehuda Ayash heard in Algiers, and what was going on in Yerushalayim, it was years earlier. But then from 1749 on, they weren't doing it anymore. And so this, the last funeral was that of the Pri Ha'aretz of Rabbi Meir Mizrahi. He was the last one that was still done in Yerushalayim. הדרופף המנהג של חליסת כתף או שפסק כלם להיות. ולכן, איתי שפיר מה שכתב הרב שוחן גבוה ולא ראיתי עוד, כל לומר שמאז לא ראה עוד. From that point on, he no longer saw it. ועל ידי זה נסלקו התמיהות לעילותם הסותרו של רב רבי קדישי מלאכי אלוהים המה. And this obviously helps to do away with all the problems that we have. אחר זמן זכינו לאורו של הספר הבהיר מאור ישראל השס, לגאום זרם של הדור הגר רבי עובדי יוסף. ובחידושיו במועד קטן כתב בשלמו, והנה אף שהרמה במפה כתב שעכשיו בזמן הזה לא נהגו לחלוס כתף כלל, מקום מקום הרב שולחן גבוה העיר שבבטירת הגאון בישראל ממזרחי יעשו לפניהם מיטתו בעיניו תמידה ואחד עושה כתב וכן נכון להמשיך לנהוג כן בירושלים. So Chacham Ali Yosef, after he wrote all this, Rabbi Shelomo Dayan says, because after a while after writing this, I saw now a book called Me'or Yisrael, it's Hidushim on the Gemara, written by Chacham Ali Yosef, and Chacham Ali Yosef brings this incident when he's writing Hidushim on Malkatan, and he brings the incident from the, he quotes the Shulchan Gaboa, talking about the incident, you know, of what was going on, and he says over there, since this was the minhag in Yerushalayim, we should bring this back, and we should do it in Yerushalayim again. V'chein nachon lehamshich linhog kem Yerushalayim. It is proper for us to continue this custom in Yerushalayim, avdum chalisat katef. Umihu, im haben gadol b'torah, lo yahalos katef kedei shelo yitbazeh b'fnei hamon ha'am v'talmidav. But if the guy is a gadol b'torah, he should not do it, so he will not be an embarrassed, he will not pose an embarrassing situation, you know, to the hamon'am, to the multitudes, to the riffraff, to the common folk, with amidav. Moshe Maram Shaharuch, Shim Habin Adam Gadol Ve'en Kibodo Shereh Halus Katev Al Aviv In Sarich Lahalos. If it's something dishonorable for a person to walk around like that, and people are going to make fun of it, he shouldn't do it. He's saying that, and that's what I told people to do. Even though we should be doing it here, I think it's going to cause too much of a mockery, and so I tell people not to do it. Even though he's saying we should do it, that we should reinstitute this minhag in Yerushalayim, because I can't see, you know, how we can do it, because for important people, if you're a regular person, you're a regular guy, you don't have talmidim, you don't have a big business, that people look up to you, you know, like something, you're not an important person in government, so you go and do it, very nice. Nobody's going to create an issue out of it. But if you're an important person, people are going to start laughing. מחד ברכות שוש כתב שנכון להמשיך לנהוג כמושלים, אתה שומע שהבנים יוסעים אחר מיטת אביהם. Because the point I wanted to bring up from this, okay, is that he said that yes, the sons should do this. Because that all doesn't only mean revealing the shoulder. It means the son should also go to accompany the coffin.
Wow.
This is why I brought it.
Wow.
By implication.
Right. Yeah? Yes. But nice point.
Question about this revealing the shoulder thing. The mourners, right, aren't they usually in their house? They're not walking around like this.
No, this is just in the cemetery.
This is the funeral.
The funeral.
The way the funeral would work is you would walk from the house of the deceased, okay, and you would walk. The same way A.B. saw the Shammy funeral, and he saw the walking and stopping, and the walking and stopping at different points. This is the way it worked. You would walk from the house of the deceased to the house of, let's say, the eldest child. From that, you would stop at the kinnies. From the kinnies, you would stop at the next kinnies. Then you would stop at the entranceway of what you call of the cemetery. Then you go into the cemetery. And each place, and you stop and say Kaddish, and you know, it was a whole big thing. Correct, Ib?
Yes.
There you go.
We need a clip every once in a while, you know? That's
crazy. I think it's even more so.
Am I crazy? Do you disagree with me?
They stopped the minhag. They stopped one minhag, halakha. They didn't stop this one. Meaning to say
Show
that.
Say it again?
In the same sentence of the halakha, that you shouldn't go with that your shoulder revealed. They stopped that one, but they didn't stop the other one. That's his point.
Right. I'm lost.
The minhag of taking of the son.
Revealing your shoulder. Right. We stopped that minhag. That's the one we stopped. They should have said we also stopped this one.
Who's they?
Whoever stopped it. Whoever.
Well, who said anything?
No, I'm saying he's trying to say that.
No.
This stopped.
No. I don't buy it. No,
it's not a buy. Why are you not buying?
Because that's all he's saying. Get old.
No, but it's a further point. That they always went. But you can also read into it. They never. We could say at least read into it that they never stopped going before the.
He's not even tackling that yet. He's not even getting there yet. He's just using this as, you know, as a back door.
So, what?
That's how I see it.
No, I mean, that's...
Question about the detail of revealing the shoulder. They used to do that from at what point? Before they went to the cemetery?
Before.
Before.
Yeah, they're walking in the street. Here's the hearse.
Once the funeral procession begins.
Uh-huh. Your shirt's right.
Once the funeral procession begins.
It's not the keriyah, it's just the right. revealing of the right. shoulder.
And meaning if they're doing that, they're following the coffin.
Yes.
They're walking through the blocks with the stripped shirt with the arm showing. So.
Like, you know how you see these, jacket guys in the morning, how they take off their jacket and they button the jacket so they can put on the tefillin.
But I was just curious about, like, when they did it, because I get the point is from
the very start of the funeral.
Right. Gotcha. So if they're doing that, of course they're taking the... They're following
So now, bottom line is, we know till approximately 250 years ago, give or take a few years, they were still doing halisat katif, as is stated in the Beraita, is stated in the Rishonim, stated in Shulchan Aruch. We know this was still going on. V'im kol ze ha'idana min yekere va'ad'ata lo nehaguke. And we know in this list that we said less than three centuries, they abandoned this halakha. ובאתו הלכה פסוקם שערוך. They took the shahar, the halakha, they were following שערוך, they removed it. Took it, tossed it out. מהטעם דחשי בלן השתה זילותה רבה. והבאלה כמו אין כבודו שבימיהם. And they took it out because this is called zilzul, and this is not, wouldn't be honorary to anybody. כל שכם וקל וחום בדבר שאינו נוגד את הלכה, وَمْنِعَا شَبَّنِي مِلْخُوا أَحَرْ أَرُونَ أَبِهِمْ شَيَيْشٍ هُوْكَيْنِ. He goes, now, by removing this, and this is what, I guess what Marky was trying to say before, by removing this halakha, they automatically, with it, removed the sons going to the cemetery. Something that does not cause any sort of zilzul, something that does not cause any ikavod, something that does not cause any hilul Hashem. Let's see where we're going now.
I understand.
Okay, let's go back. We have a halakha. Halakha tells you that for a parent, you must reveal your shoulder. Okay? And you reveal your shoulder and you walk the funeral procession from point A till the burial.
Okay.
This halakha went on in Yerushalayim till approximately 1749. It still existed. From 1749 till today, so we're up approximately 265 years, it's not going on anymore. By stopping this halakha, by erasing it out of Shulchan Aruch, because that's technically what they've done.
They took out that halakha.
By not doing this halakha applies to when you're going with the father. You know, so now automatically, we did away with the rest of the halakha that goes with it. כל שכם וכל החומר דבר שאינו נוגד להלכה ואינו מניעה שהבנים ילכו אחר העולם בהם כשנו כן. כי יש בזה כבוד החיים המתים. This gives honor, this gives proper respect to the deceased and to the living. ומי שלא הולך העידנה אחר העולם אביב יחשב הדבר לזילות הרבה. And not going after your father's casket, after your father's body, that's considered a zilzul. That's belittling. That's berating. Right? Yeah, Dad, who cares about you? You know, I'm not going. Really, think about it.
Look at this kid. He doesn't go to his own father's funeral, he's not going.
Everybody else is going.
Where's the respect? Oh, madam. Sheikh, woman, had ha'ulam. And look around you. Everybody goes. The Muslims go, the Christians go, the Buddhists go, the Batiks go, the Shafuas go, everybody go, and Am Yisrael, Kiddushin Tehorim, they don't go. What kind of messed up nation is this? Am I right or wrong?
Messed up nation.
Messed up people.
ובפרט יש להחמיר בזה לאלה שנהגו כאלה מחוסר. So at least be מחמיר, okay? People that had this minhag in Husla Aras before they made Aliyah, you know, let them keep doing what they were doing. ורואים בכך כבוד האחרון ללכת אחר האלון עד מקום הקבורה. And now they see this as, you know, I'm doing, you know, the final last wishes of the deceased by going with him, granting the proper honor and respect. והבית וראה, כמה השתדלויות עושים כדי שהבנים יתלו חלק בלוויה של אביהם קבורתו ואם הבנים חייסו ארץ, מלינים את המת עד שהגיעו הבנים. And look how much they do, for, you know, for the proper respect for the deceased. And even, you know, they push off the funeral as much as possible if they know the child is out of the country for the, you know, for the child to get back in time. Because in pnei kipida hagidola shemakpidim liyot nochahim levot ta'aba b'derko aharonad b'et alamo, so they could be present to, you know, walk him those last few steps to on his way to the afterlife, to, you know, to alamo. ואם מסיבה התעכבו בדרך ולא היה סיפק בידם להגיע, and for whatever reason, if they got delayed and they could not arrive, כמה עינוי נפש ורוח ודאבון לבב יש להם ומשפחתם. How much sorrow and anguish does it cause them to their families for, you know, forever, really. Okay? Well, because it's not something that you forget. You know, if, God forbid you didn't make it. You know, I know my mother was away when my grandmother passed away. She could not make it back in time for my grandmother's funeral. We tried the impossible. It just wasn't, yeah. Didn't happen. Till today, it bothers her. She wasn't able to make it back in time. It's years already. It kills her. ובדל שזה מורה ובא לעניין הנפש הקישורה בסרור האהבה בין האבות לבנים. This is the, that final tie that holds together father and son, you know, parent and child. It's something tremendous. וקרחם אב על בנים. בניחר אב שיש גם לבנים מעשה הקיבורה. And it gives, you know, real consolation to the children when they know that they laid their parent to rest when the time comes. ונחר הבא לאב כשבנה ויוסף חלסה מלווים אותו כמו שכתב הרב הקדוש מעבר יבוק. And we know from the מעבר יבוק, he says it gives proper satisfaction to the deceased when that neshama knows that its offspring came and laid it to rest the proper way. והגם שהם מנהג בירושלים תתברא ותכונן, שאין הבנים הולכים אחר ארון אביהם. לא כל עמה גמיים מנהג זה, ואין דעתם מתקבל מתיישבת עם המנהג. Goes to the people, the general people. The, not everybody knows how to accept it, and not everybody is at peace with this custom, and it seems very strange in their eyes. Because it's not something that goes on throughout the world. And not even in other cities within Israel itself. So then, stopping the children from going after their father's casket. This is considered, you know, a major upheaval. And especially to those communities and those families, that this Jerusalemite custom seems strange, something we've never heard of before. Doesn't bury all the time. Us Baghdadians, we have all types of strange superstitions, and even we never heard of this. Don't you say that all the time?
Yes, yeah, this.
It's a good one.
You've been yelling that for the last 3-4 weeks, the same line every week. And this is something that we know throughout the Jewish world, that when a parent dies, the children go to, you know, to lay the parent to rest. He would ask about this question and to explain what's going on. And he responded, and obviously this is a very small section of his response. Minhag ze shel mini'at habanim lalechet aharei aron abihim ein lo makor b'talmud u b'divrei haposkim harishonim. Has no source to disallow the children from going. There is no source for this, not in the Gemara, and not in the words of the Poskim Rishonim. Ve'adrabba, and all the more so, min ha-deen, based upon the halakha, the deen, hayyabim habbanim lisat aron abihim, amma kun kibulato b'halisat katif. The children are obligated to carry the body of their fathers until its final resting place while doing halisat katif. Ukhmo shakatab maran sha'al kodam metim arasa halis katif. And like the way Maran wrote, for any deceased, if you want to expose your shoulder, you can. But for a father and a mother, you are obligated to halos katif. And you have to walk this way front of the casket until it is buried. So it's clearly laid out. There is a mizvah, and not just a mizvah, but an obligation, to accompany the body until it's buried. Umnam mukomot yidu'im nahagul imnoa yisayat habbanim ahare aron abihim bita'ame razin timirin. But as we know, there are places where they prevent the children from doing it because of these hidden mysteries. Ve'chach nahagul be'Israel. And this seems to be the custom in Israel. Abad berob kehilot hagula shil aidot ha-sefaradim lo nahagul debarze. But in most places where the sefaradim live outside of Israel, they don't have such a prevention. Hilkach in mhod bidei bnei chustaas harusim lechabed et abihim hadvayatam et aronu al makom kibrato. And therefore, if somebody's coming from outside in Israel to bury, you really shouldn't be stopping him. Velo od illa sheham mohay b'davar ze eno illa gorem mahlok b'Israel. And somebody that what do you call it, you know, tries to reprimand and stop this, he's only causing mahloket. And the spirit of the Hachamim obviously is not at ease with this person. And this is basically the gist of what Rabbi Uziel had to say. Now he says, now I'm going to start looking at this custom of Jerusalem, what's it based upon? Umahim ta'amir azin tamirin shikadaf harab aliyon al-ma'ala. And what are these hidden mysteries that Rabbi Uziel mentioned above? Hine ra'iti laharab ha-hasid, morin harab Yehiel Michael Tukachinsky, lechasik lebracha, besefer Gesher ha-hayim, chedek rishon, shikadaf, דקודם שמוסיעין מהבית מת זכר, מכריזין בחרם, כי כל זרעו לא ילבוהו ולא ילכו אחר מיתתו כלל וכלל. And goes to the first point, Rabbi Tukachinsky, writes in his book Gesher HaHayim, that before they remove the deceased from the home, they basically make a proclamation of Harim.
What?
Okay. Hasefaradim vahibra kadisha kadadid shal ashkenazim makhizim b'harim yushua b'nun. And this is a proclamation that's made that all of the offsprings, all the offspring of this individual that passed away, will not accompany him and not go after his coffin whatsoever. ועל פי זה אין הולכים בארץ הקודש אחר מיתתו. And due to this, obviously, they don't go after the body. שום אחד מבניו ובנותיו יוצא חלציו. Obviously, none of the children, not the son, not the daughter, nobody. ובמקום שהבן מוכרח להיות בבית הקברו לסדחי קיבורתו, הוא יוצא קודם שמוסיעין את המת. And since he cannot go with the body, they take this child beforehand, and he's not there for any of the funeral procession, and they take him straight to the cemetery. okay, and waiting for the body to arrive. ובמקרה שהבנים או הבנות הנכדים אין שומעים לפקודת החברה קדישה. And in the case where the children do not heed the words of the חברה קדישה, והם מלווים את אביהם או זקנם אחר מיטתו, and they do accompany their father or their grandfather after his passing, ראוי שלא יכריזו כלל אותו הכרזה. It's worthy, obviously, for them not to make this proclamation. ואולי יכריזו בלא חרם בנושא אחר. Or maybe they should make this, you know, this statement, this decree, this proclamation, without חרם, or use a different text. היינו שיפרטו שלא ילבוהם מזרעו שאינו כשר. וכולי. עד כאן. So I finish quoting now Rabbi Tukachinsky. ובהערות שם, כתב הטעם על פי הקבלה. And in the footnotes, he wrote reasoning according to the Kabbalah. שמטיפות הזרע, הבלתי כשרים, מתהווים יסורים, טמאים, מזיקים. שבמשך הזמן מתגדלים, מלבשים, בלבושים, גופניים של שרדין ורוחין. That over the course of time, whatever seed spilled from this individual that did not become a normal human being, one of his children, basically was left hanging, if you will, like we discussed briefly last time, and it took upon the clothing and body and form of different types of nether spirits. והם הם נגעי בני אדם פוגעים בו וגורמים לו מרעים בישים גם בחייו. And these nether spirits, these demons, if you will, these are what causes all types of calamities, okay, throughout the person's life. ופטירתו של אביהם מולידם מתלווים הם אל אביהם, מלפפים אותו, ולא ירסו להיפרים ממנו, מטמאים, מזדהמים, ומסערים אותו עד מאוד. And when the father passes away, these spirits come, and they attach themselves to him, and they do not want to let him go, and they defile him, you know, and they cause him all types of sorrow and anguish. ואינם מרשים לו לחזור למקום מחסבתו הקדוש, and they do not allow him to go on to his holy place. ויסורי הרוח האלה, and these spirits, if you will, אין משלם ואין להם סיור בזה העולם, obviously they have no form that we know of in this world, ומשום כך עושים מסביב למד עוד כמה עניינים כגון הקפו ועוד כהנה למען הרחיקם ולבערה מעליו עד כמה שאפשר. And obviously, since we can't really see them and we cannot, you know, actually physically pull them away, one of the things we do before the burial and when we clean the body, we do different types of circumferences around the body. We keep going around, say hakafot and all different types of prayers to try to eradicate these spirits. ומנהג זה שאין יוסעי חלסיו מלווין לאביהם וזקניהם. And this custom of the children not going after the father or the grandfather, לא מסינו בספרים, we did not find it in the, on the books. מלפנים נהגו גם בישראל לבות אביהם. And in days of old, yes, they used to accompany the father. וכולי. והיין עוד שם באורך שהביא מהתוספתא, בית יוסף, והגירה, והרמה, ודקדקי, מחדי הפנים, שמדבריו מוכר שאפילו בתקופה האחרונה לפני כ-250 שנה היה בירושלים הבן בין המלווים. And it would seem that based upon everything he wrote, everything we've been able to find, until about 250 years ago, yes, the children did accompany the father. ובסוף דבריו כתב, and in the end he writes, ואחרי שתקנת ההכרזה הלזו קבלוה וקיימו על זה הלבנו אדירי התורה וקבלה, ששימשו בישראל ולושלם משך כל 200 שנה, בהם בעל אורח חיים, בעל אדמת קודש, הרב ישראל יעקב אלגזי, בעל שושנים לדוד, בעל בתי כהונה, בעל הבחידה, מהרית אלגזי, ומקבל הרב שלום שרעבי, ביתם אימם גאונים בסדיקים בעלי קבלה רבים וכולי מעל הגאונים והסדיקים תמידי הגירה זלהמי ישרי היישוב האשכנזים והלאה חלילה לזלזל בהכרזה וממילא אי אפשר ליוסעי חלסה לביתו. And so this has been going on, Rabbi Tukachinsky wrote this, and he's saying at least 200 years, and we know it's on the books, and it was, you know, and it was must have been sanctioned by all these different rabbis over the years, obviously, because we don't see any of them coming out against it. We know it existed in their days already. So we cannot come out against it, and we have to leave it where it stands, and we cannot make fun of it, and we cannot annihilate it. Illa shika amur. במקום שהבן או הנכד מוכרח להיות בבית הקברות לצורך הקיבורה, but in a situation where the son or the grandson has to be at the cemetery at the time of burial, יורו לו בני החברה קדשה, so the members of the burial society need to instruct him, שיעשה מהבית קודם הוצאת המת לכל בקרות, he should leave the house and go to the cemetery directly before the body even leaves the house. ובמקום שאין יוצאי חלסיו שומעים בנקודת החברה הקדשה, יראו להם שילכו לפחות ויקדימו לצאת מהבית כל מי שמוסיף את המת ויקדימו ללכת קודם לכל המלווים בשיעור שלא יראו נשיאת המתה. And if not, at least let them go, you know, before the body goes, so at least they can't even see each other. ואם יוצאי חלסיו אין נזקקים כאלה בנקודות כאלה, and if the children, the offspring, don't want to listen whatsoever, אין להכריז הכרזה הזאת, they should not make the announcement, the decree. עד כמה דברי קודשו של הרב גשר חיים מרובה כאיש ויעיין שם באורך. So this is basically he's quoting all this from Rabbi Tukachinsky, and it seems that this was applicable among the Sephardim and the Ashkenazim. And not talking about Hasidim, we're talking about the followers of the Gera. Okay? And this seemed to be, you know, the fashion and the custom, and it didn't seem like anybody was stopping anything. ועתה הגם שידעתי כי לא בבינת אדם לי להיכנס בין ההרים הגיבוהים הנני בא כתלמיד הדן לפני רבותיו להשיב על דבריו אחת אחת בעזר משדה תחילה בראש הטעם שהביא על פי הקבלה כן הוא מבואר בזוהר הקדוש ואמר ביצחק מהי שעת הדקתיל כהן להבל התפרש אדם אצטטה תרן רוחי נוקבין הבו אתיין מזווגן עמי ואוליד רוחין ושגין לשעתן בעמה ולא תקשה לאחי דהה ברנש כד איהו בחלמי אתיין רוחי נוקבין וחייכין עמי מלחמי מאמיני ואולידין לבטר ואלין אקרון נגעי בני אדם ולא מתפכן אלא דיוקנה בני נשא ודית לו שערים ברישה ועדה כתיב בשלמה והוכחתיב בשבט אנשים לראה בני אדם ואפילו כהגבנה רוחין דחורין אתיין לנשי עלמה מתעברה מניהו בעודדין רוחין וכולהו נגעי בינה אקרון. וראה עוד מה שכתב בספר שער הכוונות בדירושי הלילה. ואחר מופלג ראיתי לגאון עוזן מרן הגאון רבי עובדיה יוסף שליטה שהביא דבריו בתמצית נפלאה בספרו יביע עומר חיידל. ולשונו, משער הכוונות שם מוסי שזל ואפילו באונס. אפילו באונס, כגון המשמש מיטתו, ואינו שוהה עד שיעשו כל הטיפים לגמרי, אותן שיעורי הטיפות היוסעות לבטלה, אף על פי שאינן ראויים להוליד על כל זה, נבראים מהם מזיקים ומשחיתים רעים, וצריך להמיתן על ידי אמירת קריאת שמע של המיטה, שיכוון על כך בקריאתו וכולי. וכן האישה שיושב בלי איש, בוראה מזריקין וכולי, עיין שם. וכן הוא בשאר המזוות, עיין שם. והנה, בפטירת מולידם של המזריקין הללו, אם יוצאים אחריו בניו בנותיו, נלווים עליהם המזריקין הללו, מלפפין אותו, מסערים אותו מאוד, ולכן, מכריזים בחרם ששומרי רע מהן נפטר, הוא יריך אחריו לבותו למנוע מהן נפטר השר הגדול הזה. ומה שלא נהגו כן בנשים נפטרו להכריז בחרם שלא ילכו אחריה בניה ובנותיה, נראה אתם פני שאישה קרקע עולם היא ונחוש בה כל כך וכולי עד כאן לשונו. So first thing, he brings us the whole section of the Zohar, but basically telling us the exact same thing that we read in Hebrew above. So he gave it to us in the original Aramaic. And then he goes on to show that it also comes from the Sha'ar HaKavanot. And then he goes and he says that Chavaya Yosef brings it in a condensed, abridged format in Yabu Omer, explaining what the Sha'ar HaKavanot is saying. And all this goes back to exactly what we've said last time in passing, and we read earlier before. Any real difference, Mark, from what we said? No difference. Great. ואני לא ידעתי ישמע. מדברי הזור הקדוש, בסדר הכוונות. כשיוסעים אחריו בנה בנותיו ויוסעי חלסיו הכישרים, שנלווים אליהם, כן המזליקים הללו, מפפפים אותו, מסענים אותו מאוד. דמית הנה הקולר ויוסעי חלסיו הכישרים, להני רוחין בישין. ודין מדי אף אם הבנים הכישרים לא ילכו אחריו לבותו לקיבורת, הנה המזיקין המלפיפין ילכו אחריו ויסערוהו, כי זה דרכם אביים כסלם להיפרע מאביהם מולידם. So, who says by the regular children not going after it, it's going to stop these spirits? You know, from doing anything. These bad spirits are bad spirits. They're going to do whatever they want to do, whether I'm there or whether I'm not there. So why should, you know, me going have any effect on them and vice versa? Umagam, shelo masalom b'dibri hazor kadosh, shehu shorish mekor debarim, shiitle elu be'ele. And if we look carefully at the words of the Zohar, we don't see any real connection of one to the other. The living to the physical living to these spirituals. ועוד, דלה שייך לומר, ומלתה דלה מסתברה היא, שאדם שלא זכה להיבנות בזרע של קיימה, שנגעה בינה, I need to figure out this נון אלף is, אדם שלא זכה להיבנו בזרע של קיימה שנראה בני אדם אלו לא יתלוו אליו אחר מיטתו ולא ילפפוהו ולא יסערוהו מפני שאין להם אל מי לתלות. אשר על כן מסתבר יותר לומר דאין לתלות ליווי המזיקים בליווי הבנים הקשרים אלא יש לומר בכל מקרה מתלווין השדים ורוחים שנבראו מזרעו הפסול בין אם ילבוהו בענייו הקשרים, ובין אם לא ילבוהו. אם לא שזכה לבערם בעודו בחיי חיותו על ידי תשובה ותיקוני הנפש הסליחים לכך, הוא נמעל מנהון על ידי קריאת שמע של המטה, שזה תיקונם להחזירה למקום מחסבתם על הקדושה, כמו שכתב של כוונות. והנה כדי לתקן עוון זה צריך שיעמיד אותם הגופות הטמאים, הבישים לאותם הנשמות ועל ידי כן אותם הנשמות יברחו משם ויחזרו אל שושם שבקדושה. גם יש עוון אחר דומה לזה והוא מי שמשמש מיטתו ואינו שוהה עד שיעשו כל הטיפין לגמרי, כי אותם שיעורי הטיפות היוסעות לבטלף על פי שאינם ראויים להוליד, על כל זה נבריאים מהם גם כן בחינת מזריקים ומשחיתים רעים על דרך הנסתרת. ומכל זה תבין סוד גדול הנאמר בזוהר פרשת בלק על פסוק הפסוק לא ישכב על יאכל טרף. ובדרושי חז"ל בעניין אותם אלפים ורבבות של מזריקים שהאדם ממית מכל לילה על ידי קריאת שמע על המיטה, וצריך אדם לכוון בכל קריאת שמע שאומר על מיטתו לכוון בתיקון עוון זה ולהמיד כל אותם הגופות של המזיקים והנזכרים וכולי. אני חושב כי עיקר התיקון הוא שיכוון להמיט על ידי קריאת שמע של המיטתו אותם הגופים של המזיקים, ועל ידי כן יוכל האיש הזה לעלות עם נפשו אותם הנשמות למעלה אל הקדושה לתקנם בכל לילה וכולי על כאן לשונו. So, bottom line, this paragraph, he's telling us he sees no real connection between that the actual physical bodies that were created by this human being and these nether spirits that were created. And he doesn't see why one going, you know, would cause the other to go and vice versa, or one not going would stop the other one from going. Because these are bad spirits, they're going to come do bad things no matter what, has nothing to do with me. He goes, but if this is the way the tradition falls, this is the way the tradition is, I can't do anything about it, this is not my field. He goes, but, you know, person needs to do teshuvah and tikkunei nefesh, he needs to go through certain formulas to get rid of these things, and the greatest of the formulas to get rid of these evil spirits that are hanging around is through having, you know, very, very focused thought when you say Kiryat Shema al Mitta. And even if it's later on in life, you could still work on this Kiryat Shema al Mitta to have Kevinot to get rid of these Shedim from your system and have them return to their proper place. And then he goes on to tell you, you know, you have to be very careful, you know, if you don't pull out too prematurely, because if you do, you know, extra drops could fall out, even though it's too late for them to develop into anything, they still had a potential. So be careful with that, too.
So who's saying this?
Shara Kavanot.
Oh, okay.
Shara Kavanot is telling you to do the Shema and not to pull out and stuff like that. As far as the first part, that's the author over here, Rabbi Dayan.
Right. Okay. And that's 16th century,
Shout out to Rabbi Dayan. So the way you're going to get rid of them. So when we go to the funeral and we sing Yushayb Sidr Alyon, that is the Mizmor, the 91st Mizmor. Mm-hmm. It's called Shir Shel Pegaim, and that the reason that is said is to banish all these spirits from the body. Yeah. Now you know. Voreh Mashkala B'Sefer Hamdat Yamim. Sefer Hamdat Yamim is another very interesting book. Anonymous. Could have been written by Natan Azati.
Yeah.
But
we did that yesterday.
I still don't believe he was. V'zeh L'shono. V'aharti fila yomar kaddish ad le'ila.
Isn't that the one we did here?
What?
Shavuot night? Shavuot? No.
What was the question?
When we read the... We take out Sefer Torah for... Take out Sefer Torah for Yom Tov. Oh, he could have written it also, you said.
All those things that were called. All those tefillot that you say, Rosh Hashanah, Kippur, they're all from Hamdat Yamin.
That's what I mean.
Kaddish ad le'illah. ויאמר והיא נועם וכולי, יושב בסדר וכולי, ונתקן לומר מזמור זה, כי הוא שיר של פגעים, והוא נאמר על כל דבר, אם אתה ופחד על המקטרגים. Hey, Saturday night we say this, also, to banish all these things. Start of the week without any, you know, things holding us back. ולפי כי עתה הם יוסעים מנוקבה לתהומה רבה, אנו מעתירים שלא יקטרגו עלינו ולא ישלו בנו. Now the time, Saturday night, everything comes flying out. So we have to block them. Shulato kisigula kireshema sherhi ramach v'herpifiyot Lashmit Makatrigim. Okay? Don't we say the Kiryat Shema is 248 words? Ramah, Ramah being Romah. Romah is like a spear. He used this spear like a sword to kill these things. Na'alken, Yesh, Mivihi No'am. Abishu'ati, Hattebosh Kiryat Shema, Hasir Hattebot. If you count the words, okay, from Vihi No'am until Bishu'ati, you have the same thing, less five. Well, Ficha Kuflim Pasuk Orechemim Ere. So why do you say the Pasuk Orechemim twice to add the extra five? Shish Bohe Tevot, the Hashim is part Tevot, Keret Shema. Ma'akan Shono. You got that?
Wow.
Yes, no, you didn't know. None of you know that before.
Yeah, can you explain
that? Yeah, I knew that before.
Can you explain that?
Sidur stuff I'm into. Saturday night. Mm-hmm. Right? After the Amidah, what do we do?
Yosheb Eset Elyon.
Okay, yeah.
Yes, no, maybe?
Yeah, right.
So now, if you count the words from Vihi No'am until Bishu'ati, you have. Until Bishu'ati, you're going to have how many words? You're going to have 243. You're missing five to get to that total of 248. So you repeat that Pasuk Orechemim Esbirai Bishu'ati to give you the extra five. So now you have 248. That 248 is parallel to the 248 words of Shema. The Shema is what you would be saying in Kiryat Shema al Hamittah, which is the 248. 248 equals Resh Mem Het. Resh Mem Het is Romah. Romah is a spear. You use this spear to kill these demons. The same thing Saturday night when they're all coming out. You're using it to kill them, to keep them away from you, so they don't come and attach to you and ruin everything for you all week long.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, now you all like it. Oh, okay.
I do actually.
Mark is not praying that anymore. I know that.
No, I'm only saying Orechemim once.
That's all right.
I know it doesn't.
Shai Ruhin Niskirin Lo Yahushu Tikunim Haniskirin حديثا إن كان لما شيء حوش يوتى لما هناك شيء إنه بني ملفين شاف هم لو يلبوه معود دمي جلا راز شيء هم بني كشرين لو يلبوه أز هم يمنعوا أسماء مثل فوتا وما دوا لو إن فارس شو هذا بني مزور كلو إبرير بن أريز منها بني هم مزور سكيرة بتكونين شو عصيم سبيل ما يش لهم بني أب لقدوا لك وحاش في اللغة حنونين لفنه إل شو خير معونين להחריט את החוחים והכוסים מסובבים את המת, כמו שיעו משופטי נפשו, ואין לנו על מה לשמור, כי אם על רחמי השם השומע כל תחינת עמו ישראל ומעשה כדי גאולתו להשים תיקון נפש רוח ונשמה, ובלי ספק שיתעסק האלוהים ויחיש את דלתו, ויחוס יחום וירחם על נשמתו. הל כביל וימאס תפילת רבים עבור הנפטר והרבה להשיא פה לא יעיר וחמתו. So bottom line is, even if you want to say all this is nonsense, so don't think about it, it's not your thing, you know, but bottom line is tefillah, and tefillah obviously is something that we can do in a positive way to help affect things for us, so we're praying to Borei Olam, but not going, you know, to accompany the body to the funeral. I still don't see how it fits in and where it came from, and if he's telling you that the way I see it, I don't see it clearly detailed in the Zohar and not in the writings of the Ari or anything else that we have. So I'm still, you know, troubled and puzzled by what's going on over here.